And now on probably a more sophisticated note, maybe, Jim Stark, Dad.
I have a poem.
Oh!
Very clever title. Very creative. Herrick. How do I do it? I mean, it's just amazing. My poem. You appeared on the scene in my Navy. Where is Eric? Go there. You appeared on the scene in my Navy days. The best part of that was the government pays. Lots of fussing and whining. What's the big deal? It's your mother, I'm quoting. Your stubborn arrival was real. Counting contractions. You don't hear my hollers. I'm hoping this kid is worth $25. Quite clever you were, speaking in initials. Prince Perfect, Mom called you. PP you prefer. Your Valentine card, I still have it yet. Happy VD, M&D. That's as good as it gets. Basketball was not really your thing.
Hey, now, I stuck with it for 3.5 years.
The boys' club's games would not bring you fame. We rooted, we cheered, we encouraged you on, but Big Ten attention was obviously gone. Then there was that one incredible game. Would Bobby be calling and whisper your name? It wasn't rebounds or free throws or points, I recall. For the very first time, you just touched the ball. I had aspirations of instructor flight training. A student I needed to practice instructing. You were my pupil. Took serious the assignment, touch and go landings and landing alignment. Years later, you signed up for a license and more, and the instructor asked, ever done this before? Yeah, you said, my dad took me aloft. Okay, said he, take the controls, climb, level off. You controlled that plane like Rachmaninoff. He asked where you practiced and why you're so great, and you said, my dad gave me lessons when I was just 8. Whitewater rafting with all 3 young Starks, rode the turbulent waters through Grand Canyon Park, whirlpools and boulders, holding tight was a trick. My God, we just lost one. Was that our Eric? $25 has paid off big time. The world reaps the rewards of a talent so fine. Kennedy Center, Carnegie Hall, I beam from your audience and boast one and all. Chip off the block, that's my boy up there. My reward has been zillions, and that I declare.
Little AV assistance here because I'm representing both brothers. This is not, it's not bad.
There's not like this.
So his baby brother Brian lives in Tucson and couldn't be here, but he put together a cool little video that he asked me to show, so I will launch that here. This is Nisa's.
It's your birthday. Happy birthday. It's a great day.
Yes, it is.
Wow.
Do we really know that, Tim?
There we go.
We know that.
That's where you're really right.
Many more cartwheels in the waves.
So I, being fortunate to be born just, you know, a little over 2 years after you, have been able to share 48 years of your 50 plus or minus with you, and this could be a really good roast, but I thought, you know, I'll save that for your 100th because that'll give us 50 years more of good ammo. But thinking back of our first 48 and the birthdays, the one thing that stuck out of my mind is that song that mom or dad or whoever bought us on a little floppy record back in 1976. Happy birthday, Eric. It's your birthday. You remember that from Captain Zoom?
Oh!
So, I was able to track down Captain Zoom.
No way!
And he wanted to wish you a happy
Captain
Zoom. Well, he's recorded something for you, so. Hold on. You can all sing along if you know.
This is Space Command to Zoom. All systems are go for your message to Eric.
Hey, Eric, it's your birthday.
Great grandma.
I'm in charge of the stars, and I'm here to say, hey, Eric, you're the big star today. My name is Zoom, and I live on the moon, but I came down to Earth just to sing you this tune. It's your birthday today. A present for you I wanted to find, an outer space creature, a one of a kind.
Mom, do you remember?
A wild one, or a Google chew, or a buzzer spoon, or maybe a three-eyed tickle shake for your birthday.
There's Kiki
Dallas. What's a tickle chew?
What's that one do for you on your birthday? I search behind the clouds and stars. I even
areas of the world that he hasn't been to, which is very hard because he's been to so many areas of the world that I haven't been
Why
to.
Why don't you go over there?
Okay. Just ask me to help and then you're pushing me out. So many of you may have already received or seen on Facebook that I took him to a very special place of my own, Glacier Park, Montana. last summer. In fact, it was very interesting for me to find out that after we were there and I brought his mom a little something back from the park that you had been there
as a child.
Yes. And she talked to me about the steamer trunks that the help had brought in and their lederhosen to Mini Glacier Lodge. And I mean, you have to remember, this is something that's dear in my heart for like 35 years, and I find out all of a sudden his mom has already been there. So anyway, one of the things that you may or may not be familiar with that Eric and I share is our love of beer. And we do, and so we hike very aggressively. We paddleboard our calories away. But at the end of the day, we normally allow ourselves that wonderful bit of brew. And we always have a tendency to go to the local ones. We don't go anything. We always go to a different microbrewery or find something we've never had before. So when we were in Glacier Park, we had our little cooler all packed. We came off the mountain, and unfortunately, we got to our car and we didn't have a bottle opener.
Oh.
So of course that wasn't acceptable because we had to find a bottle opener because we have beers that we need to be consuming. So Dr. Stark, we made our way down the mountain and we went into one of the first gift shops. And out of the first gift shop, he comes with the bottle opener, but there's a bit of a consternation on his part about it. I'm like, what's going on? And he's like, the only bottle opener I could find in there cost $11. Said Montana on it. I said, but it opens our beers. The entire time of the rest of our trip, this was the discussion of him going into every other gift shop and finding a cheaper bottle opener. The bottle opener there is only $2. There it's only $3. It's like, we've got an $11. So I did not buy a gift. I am giving this back to Dr. Stark to put on his refrigerator as a magnet for him to enjoy as we share it together.
Yes.
And I'm sure we will enjoy many more beers together.
Is it $11?
This is truly to be treasured.
Yeah.
If anybody wants to see the gold plate,
there it is.
I'll use it to put up mom's contraction schedule.
There you go. Now it's invaluable.
Dr. Davis, would you like to join me? I forgot my sustain pedal, so this will be a little choppy. I'm sorry. So, Dr. Stark, in the five minutes or so that I put into this song, I really poured my heart and soul into it.
Thank you.
Yes, but please do not let the amount of time that I put into it be a reflection on how I feel about you, because if that were the case, I would have put 2 minutes.
Rough crowd.
Yes. Dr. Davis and I wrote some words to a song. How many Carpenters fans do we have?
Oh!
I didn't have the time to actually do an original tune, so I apologize for that. Dr. Davis and I have not practiced.
We're well warmed up.
So we're going to do our best, but this is for you.
I love the tone that you're getting.
Isn't that lovely? Yeah.
Greeting cards have all been sent. The birthday rush is through. We still have one wish to make, a special one for you.
LK is missing.
Happy birthday, Maestro. You're 48
plus 2.
But you can dream, and in your dreams,
you look like 22.
Mother Stark is beaming.
50 years of joy.
Only 5 hours of contractions. Cause in her heart, you'll always be her darling. gifts.
That's true.
On this day, we hope you know this song will have to do.
And the wrinkles on your face, you wear with such grace, a sign of a life well lived. And through, for youth you yearn, we don't give a darn. So we'll just smile and say, happy birthday, maestro.
And many more to come, when other friends have flown the coop. Your go-to meal is chicken soup.
And your baton begins to droop. Oh. Happy birthday, maestro. Big finish.
And here's to 50 more.
We all need a moment of silence.
Oh my God. That was fabulous.
Oh, you're welcome.
It's the least we could do, really. Oh. I think I'm sorry. I'll be right back.
We've only just begun.
I thought of rewriting the never die, but I was in a mission last
night. Yes, you were busy.
Okay, I will say something on behalf of Michael and I. John Vanella, Michael Petrie's husband, and we had the privilege of, well, Michael has had the privilege of working with Eric for like 25 years now or something like that. Or maybe 20.
Wait a second.
But we had the privilege of living around the corner for Eric for a number of years, which meant an awful lot of nights at the local, fantastic,
very exclusive dining establishment
with,
did you get me one of the mirrors?
Young ladies on mirrors in Budweiser bathing suits.
Yes!
Called the Dugout. So we spent an awful lot of many evenings after rehearsals. And it was a pleasure and continues to be a pleasure to be your friend and part of our family. And we love you and we wish you many, many happy more. And we are so grateful to have you among our closest. So congratulations to you.
Just keep in mind that I hired this guy, Butler, so whatever you can think.
Cousin Steve is here.
Yay. This is Cousin Steve. Yay.
I was really all prepared to do something, except that I saw on Facebook this morning, and we all know if it's on Facebook, it's got to be true, that there was that dark humor was a warning sign of dementia. I kid you not. I don't. Did anybody else see that on? I was a little concerned. Come on. So I'm staying away from the dark humor, but I do want to say that I do think that my relationship with Eric has a kind of element of fate to it. So if you'll bear with me, a couple of sign points. The person that Eric replaced at Butler, Michael Schaffsberger, was a student of mine at USC when I was teaching there. So that was a kind of an interesting thing. And oh, by the way, I told Eric earlier, when Sherry and I moved here, when I took the position as dean at Butler, dean of fine arts, I was turning 50 that very summer. So you know, I'm getting, that was a bit a while ago. I get it.
So anyway, we have that. Then early on in our relationship, I had the distinction of having to sit him down and say, you know, if you really want tenure at this institution, you're going to have to finish your doctorate. Which, of course, he did with flying colors and so forth. Well, the interesting thing is that exactly that same conversation I had with my first boss at Potsdam University in upstate New York when I was hired there to teach. And so I thought, well, that's kind of an interesting thing.
If you hadn't written it into my contract, I probably never would have.
That's not true. That's not true. I appreciate it. The other thing is that I'm not sure whether I had the idea, but soon after Eric started, he started going to the Bach Festival in Eugene, Oregon. I don't know that I had the idea to send him there to work with Helmut Rilling, but I had worked with Rilling many years before that. And certainly I encourage you to go. I don't know whether I had the idea, but that was an interesting thing that we shared, because I think you would agree that sort of changed our lives.
And you were a reference. Tom Somerville called you, I think.
Oh, that's right. That I went to. Yeah, I was a reference, so that we have that. And of course, we have some very famous composers that we have in common. But again, it's not about me, it's about Eric. I just want to say that my love for Eric is built on a lot of respect that I have for him, not only as a musician, but as a person, the way he treats people, the way he treats his students, the way he treats his colleagues. And when Eric conducts, and this is not true of a lot of people, when Eric conducts, he puts his ego in his pocket. It's all about the music, and I think we would all understand that and agree with that. And for that reason, Eric, I sort of want to think of you as a mini-me, but with more talent.
Less hair.
But anyway, Sherry and I love you very, very much.
It's their anniversary today also.
Yes.
I meant to say that. I said to Sherry, now, honey, would you like to go out and have dinner with me? Or would you like to see your boyfriend? And she said, I think I'd rather see my boyfriend. There we are.
Just to break your steam,
do
you want red or white wine, beer? What do you want?
I'm fine. Thank you.
I want to be sure you all know some of Eric's family if you haven't had a chance to meet them. His dad, Jim, and wife, Michelle, you know, live in Bloomington. Carolyn Seltzer, my best friend from Columbus, came up here. My brother Chris Starr, Christopher Kirby Starr, his wife Ann, who is so talented and great, beautiful daughter Ella, son Austin Kirby Starr, who just finished his freshman year at Hanover, and Sierra Dean, his girlfriend, who just finished her freshman year at Hanover, and Sam, stand up and turn around, honey.
Oh,
Samuel Jane Stark has the world's longest blonde hair, but he wears it in man. And then my sister Carol flew up from Florida with her daughter Anne just for tonight. And she's got most of her family here. This is daughter Julie and Tom, who live here in Indianapolis. Actually, Carmel, Leanne, and Steve Langton also. Carmel, so we're so pleased. And then my brother Jim Risk and his wife Mary Jo planned their son James Kirby Risk the IV's birthday party here. They're in the next room. They were in here with us because
his birthday
was on the same day, same birthday. So you saw Jim and Mary Jo and their family too. So just wanted to mention all the family. Family's important to us. So anybody else want to say anything? Oh, there
he is. Oh, yes. Okay, this is perfect after Dr. Sells, because you know when he told Eric that he needed to finish his doctorate.
I know what you're going to
say. So I was also working on a doctorate. In fact, Eric and I were working on our doctorates at the same time, and we would sort of move each other along. As you know, life is a marathon, and a doctorate is a marathon. Would you not agree?
Yes.
So we had this friendly sort of banter back and forth.
There's more crying in the
doctor. Yes, absolutely. And Jan Harrington said to me, the only good dissertation is a done dissertation. And this was something that that Eric and I talked about on many occasions. So time went on, and we would sort of, I was doing my doctorate at Florida State, he was doing his at IU. And we would have this friendly sort of banter back and forth to sort of encourage each other to finish this degree. So finally, it comes to our defense. And I meet him in the hall, and I say, Eric, I have my defense next week. He says, what day? I said, Tuesday. He says, me too. And I said, what time? He says, 4 o'clock. I said, me too. So here we, for these years have gone by where we've been doing this. We've had our defense at the very same time, different cities, very same time. And it was the most wonderful thing. It couldn't have been better. But I thought of this idea, a marathon. And Eric, who's running marathons, and as a 50-year-old running a marathon, I thought he needed a care kit. So Jeffrey and I have put together a care kit for Eric.
How appropriate.
So Eric.
Yes.
Please.
Oh.
Okay, so I'm going to hand you a little, just, well, you can stick, there's only one that needs to go first. And that is that what every singer knows, that after you run a race, you need to be hydrated.
Yes.
And so we would, here, you can take this and put this out, then after this.
Oh, nice.
Gin.
So you have to hydrate,
yes,
with gin,
of
right?
Course.
Okay, so, now you
Peter.
Now, after that, you can.
You might want to get into running.
Here, there's one more. I would like you to put your hand down there and just, you can pull out whatever you'd like, and we'll talk about it.
Oh.
Wait, you say that again.
You can put your hand down there and pull out whatever you'd like.
Is the camera rolling?
Mineral bath. So that after you have the marathon, you can rejuvenate with a mineral bath.
Yeah.
Keeping your skin nice and lovely. Okay.
You have to wash your own.
And that's the second mineral bath. Aside from that, he's going to need 2 mineral baths. All right. Keep digging, my dear. Keep digging. Oh, this is the soap.
Oh,
grandpa's
patchouli soap.
Oh! At 50, a grandpa's patchouli was the only possible choice. All right. Are we having fun yet?
Okay.
Keep digging.
Okay.
Keep digging.
Look at
those. Glasses, dear.
Badger foot balm.
Yes.
Certified organic peppermint and tea tree. A deeply moisturizing balm for dry, cracked feet and heels. Rub it in.
Absolutely. Don't you need that after you run a marathon?
Yes.
Exactly. Keep digging.
Oh.
Well, you need to eat peanuts because you need to be rejuvenated after you've run the race.
Yes.
A little bit of salt with the moisture,
yes,
right?
Yes, very
that
good.
Goes, that goes very well with,
yeah, with protein.
Yeah. Actually, they're cashews.
Oh, cashews. Oh. Who's counting?
Because I'm counting. It's a footsie, foot brush.
This is for you to rub your feet.
Can I use this with grandpa's foot balm?
Oh, absolutely. Isn't that cute?
Can you see it's in the shape of a
foot?
Aww. That's precious.
So then we can see how beautiful are the feet, you see.
More gin.
Yes.
Oh, more keeping with that theme. This is new feet. Rub on feet. Softens calluses, corns, rough, dry areas.
Yeah. How beautiful are the feet of them. Yes.
Can you sing Where the Bee Sucks?
I knew you were going to ask for Where the Bee Sucks. And this is the last thing. And this, you may open it.
All right. Dr. Eric, your birthday to-do list. Get up, ready to celebrate. Put on a tiara, an absolute must. There's one,
yeah,
on the card. Be amazing, as always. Wishing you an especially fabulous and happy birthday. Love, Jeffrey and Steven.
Wonderful.
Ooh.
And a card.
Yeah. And a gift certificate at Foot Finesse.
That's the only. I'm going to
have to
rest
Steven.
I know.
Yeah.
I know.
Thank you. Good heavens.
Well, now you just need to run another race so you can use all that stuff.
We need to run a race in Hot Springs.
Yeah.
Where should we go next?
There you go. Tell me where.
You gotta wash your own
place. Half the camera will travel.
Anyone else want to have a word? I do want to mention, you may not have seen David, didn't get here till 7:30, my dear husband. He and I were going to pick up Eric and bring him to the party. We were coming early. We left Columbus at 4 to drop a few things off here. We got here at 6 o'clock, so I stayed here. David took our dog to Eric's house to play with Rudy, so he just got here, so he's my hero. So now, when we lived in Maine, we loved Italian sandwiches and whoopie pies.
Oh, whoopie pies!
So I thought that we needed a birthday cake. And we've got the brownie bites, which I hope you'll all eat, but Eric has to have a whoopie pie.
With 50 candles?
With the magic five candles. I bet they'll go loud. Shall we sing?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Eric. Happy birthday to you.
Thank God they didn't relight. Oh my God.
Darn it, you're 50,
we have a tradition in our house of the trick candles, and
those
when
look
we
a
were,
little bit like
well, they are, but they're a little tired tonight.
A speech from the birthday club.
I just feel so blessed to have each of you here tonight, and to have each of you in my life. I am luckier than anybody deserves to be, to have such an amazing family and incredible friends. And people to share each day with. Each of you means so much to me, and that's honestly so very true. And to have a chance to celebrate a depressing occasion like with the support of you all, it ain't that bad. So thank you all very much. As my very heartfelt thanks to Mom and Dad and everybody who helped make this event happen and so special. We will collect all of the photographs and destroy them before anybody so they don't resurface at any future public events.
I was going to say, there needs to be something that's reposted.
So thank you all very, very much. And there's plenty more food, so I hope that you'll continue to
check out the illustration.